Okay, just for entertainment purposes, let's assume we don't need to panic. Within the context of Daoland health theory, Chinese medicine studies and Kung Fu studies, Taoist Kung Fu studies, of course, let's investigate a little bit about panic. Not lately, but also lately, and already for a long time, I noticed with a lot of clients and a lot of students and a lot of
friends and myself, of course, that panic seems to be quite a normal state of mind. Everybody panics when they talk about panic. Everybody panics when they get into a panic. But what is it actually, and what can we do about it? And let's try to investigate the question from the perspective of Chinese medicine and Taoist Kung Fu training.
Lao Tzu says, when you are near Tao, then everything goes smooth and everything goes perfect. And you don't even need to ask the question if you're near Tao or not. Things just happen in the right way. When you lose Tao, on the other hand, it says, Tao is never far away. It says that as a soothing remark, because when people lose Tao, they usually panic. And at the moment when they panic, they panic. As a result of the panicking state, questions comes about. What does the unification with Tao actually mean? In a short answer, you can say it means the cessation of panic. Panic and fear are the same. They are interrelated. Unification with Tao has three stages, you can say. At least, for the purpose of this talk, first stage, everything goes smooth. The second stage is that the things that are happening to you are understood. And the third stage is a sort of clairvoyance awareness of everything that happens in the world. And I don't mean with that you know all different facts, but that you have a general feel for the smooth sailing of the world or not. Like in our society, there should be the smooth sailing of understanding that things do not go right. Things smell bad, like cars, airplanes, they make noise, they are disturbing and they are stressful, and they continuously cause an adrenaline rush, which is a panic state. When we talk about overcoming panic, we basically talk about Taoist training. Taoist training and Tai Chi Chuan specifically, they are meant to help you overcome your fears. There are several kinds of fears. There's the fear of your wife or your husband or your children or your parents. There's the fear for the police, for authority, for lack of authority, for wealth, for lack of wealth, and so forth and so forth. Like when Lao Tzu talks in the Tao Te Ching, with the five senses come a lot of different kinds of sensations. And these sensations, they basically deafen our self-experience, experience of life, and as a result of this deafening, we miss a lot of things. We only use a part of our understanding and a part of our mind and a part of our awareness, because the heart is full of all the things that we come across. And the purpose of Taoist training is to empty the heart so that you can see things for what they are. Actually, that you can see things. That's basically it. In the different stages that you go through in practice, I call people princesses. When they are starting to study with me, I usually call them princess. When they start being my client, I call them princess. And I sometimes explain the reason why I do that, and sometimes it just seems to be like an Amsterdam thing. The first stage is basically being a layperson. A layperson is, you know, everybody. That's including me, of course, in many cases. The idea of a layperson is that you're not really committed to a particular kind of theory. Your mind is fragmented, your feelings are fragmented, your physical structure is fragmented, and you try to overcome that by slaving your body, by slaving your mind, and by slaving your behavior. Or sometimes giving yourself the excuse, it's my free time, it's my life, it's my body, I can do with it whatever I want. These are attitudes of panic. Then, when you go to the first stage of developing yourself, you come into the princess stage. I very often make the joke to my students, I just did it last weekend when I was in Portugal in the workshop in Beira, and the princess stage is, you're allowed to sit in the court, but you have to shut your mouth and you can only look, you can only observe things. As a starting point for students, I very often say, try to shut your mouth for 3 months and see what's happening in your life. That's the observant stage. And this is the hardcore startup of the princess stage. It is an initiation stage. And the initiation stage is a stage of being basically entering at the court, entering at the gate. And at the moment when you're entering at the gate, you are standing in the doorway. You are not yet committed to anything. You're just basically paying your ticket, or you're buying your ticket to enter into the museum, you can say. You haven't paid yet, so you haven't got entrance yet. But you're learning some things. Then the next stage is the princess stage. The princess stage is one stage further, of course, so you're sitting a little bit closer to the throne. This is called the initiation stage of being in the inner court, being in the court, you can say. So a temple or a monastery is built around a gate, a little bit like a castle, and at the moment when you come through the gate, whereas on the left, right, and on the right side, there is the tiger king, and there is the dragon king, and or the other way around, actually. And at the moment when you pass them, they have to judge you if you're pure enough for that purpose. I don't know if anybody has seen the movie of my teacher, Joost van De, and at the moment when he makes this move, this is a movement that is related to the tiger and the dragon guardians, but then on a little bit of a higher level. And I will explain it in another video when I discuss this kind of Tai Chi Chuan. The prince, at that moment when he's in the court, he can look around a bit and he gets to see some more details, like the architecture of the court, and he can meet some of the people who are staying there, he can talk with people, but relatively you are an ignoramus. We all are. At the moment when you are in the court, because of being an ignoramus, you get to ask stupid questions, and these stupid questions, they are usually helpful for yourself or for others to understand what things are about. Then the next stage, you are the queen. You are allowed inside the temple or inside the talking room, and you can sit next to the emperor, and you can next to the king, and you can talk with the king, you can convince the king, or you can try to ask for advice or explanation and stuff like this, so you have a more direct contact with the king. In a more egalitarian society, of course, when you're at the gate, you immediately have access to the king. As a rule, I use for my students that everybody should be able to ask the king, in case there is a king, of course. As a queen, you also have some ability to guide people and to help people, but you know, you're still relatively unaware of a lot of processes, and you have to become aware, like, I am really in a process of learning. And you are developing yourself, and at that moment you basically learn about ruling powers. And ruling powers is, of course, about the ruling powers over your life. And at the moment when you become a king, you go to the last initiation process, and this is the process where you actually become the master of your own life, and you start to understand the content of your life. And the content of your life is enormous. People don't usually realize, they think usually that this body and this mind is their self. But at the moment when you go do Taoist training, you start coming to realize how extensive your self actually is. And I will have to do another video on this. But it is reason enough to get into a panic sometimes. Like for instance, when you're meditating, in the meditation process, you can get through several stages of panic and you learn to calm yourself down in that panic and gradually become quiet on the inside. It's the same when you're practicing Tai Chi Chuan, you feel your body is doing all kinds of things, some things you don't like, and you get into a panic, you get into a cramp, you get into a pain or something like this. And you learn to start working together with your body, and as a result of that, you build a relationship of trust between your behavior, between your feelings, between your thoughts, and your body, and some other aspects, of course. Because you also build a relationship of trust with your environment, so you become more confident as a rule. So these are things that you start doing at the moment when you are becoming a princess. You start practicing, basically. When I say talk about this, you talk about initiation stages. And initiation actually comes in different kinds. And in all cultures, there are initiation stages. Like the first day when you go to school, or the moment when you start having your first sperm leak, or you have your first menstruation, or when you start having body hair, and so forth and so forth. So there's small initiations and large initiations. And spiritual groups and religious groups, they have what they call large initiations. And these initiations, they are usually explanations or access to information about a particular stage of life or a stage of existence. In essence, every initiation is just about this life, right? So all the initiation stages that I went through, however transcendent it seemed, it only is about this life. There is only this life according to Taoism, and there is nothing more than that. So the point is to extend life and to go through different initiation stages so that you can complete this life, and at the moment when it's complete, you can get your final form, which is also supposed to be identical with the original form that you were born with. That means the potential to the original form and to the most optimized form of existence that you can have. This is of course another story. This is about the different stages of life. I will have to do a post on that too, and I will do that sometime soon. I already talked about this topic a little bit. When we talk about initiation formats, we basically talk about five different formats. There's more, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. First one is speech. Speech, like what I'm doing now, is a form of initiation stage. I transfer information to you. And information transference is based on Sixiang. Sixiang nowadays in China is one word, but in the past it used to indicate two different kind of words, two different kind of thinking actually. And Si is the rational thinking and Xiang is the pictorial thinking. At the moment when you talk about the pictorial thinking, you talk about what we do with mobile phones nowadays, and what we do with the internet, and what we do with modern textbooks for universities, where people learn through pictures. This appeals to your emotional state, and this is for the body. This is called the Po initiation, the teaching of the Po. And the Po is a particular kind of entity in your life that has to help you on the feeling level with managing your body, making sure your body functions well. Their home is the lungs, and at the moment, when you don't take good care of yourself, you don't take good care of your health, you harm the Po. And when the Po are tired of you, then at that moment they start destroying your life, your body, your physical function. So they contribute to weaknesses and decrepit states and gradually decline through which aging and dying happens. The unfortunate thing is you can't talk with the Po. The Po are like a sort of demonic almost, yes, but they are working for Earth. So they are part of the God of Earth, and they're part of the underworld realm where people go to after death. Their bodies go there. And most people never get to the stage, past the stage of body. So their mind never really gets developed. So everything basically goes towards the Earth. Second stage is the initiation stage, of touch. Like for instance, you make a correction on somebody's body posture, or you touch the yin tang point or another initiation point in the face or in the heart or anywhere else on the body. And massage in some sense also, that's an initiation stage. It depends a little bit on who's massaging you and how they are massaging you and where they are massaging you. And it depends on the context story of the massage also. The touching stage is the induction of an experience. And the induction of an experience is also at the same time sort of permission, you might say, to experience something or to make you aware of a particular kind of something. And it always comes, of course, with a story. Just like the speech, it comes with a story. So you see that some initiation stages, they come together. Somebody doesn't come to you and touch you on a point and then say, like, this is your initiation. Although there are sometimes funny stories. I remember one time coming into a Buddhist temple in Wuhan, and I run into a monk, and the monk greets me, and we talk a bit, and then he just takes my index finger and he holds it for a while, and he looks me in the eyes, and then he says, and then he goes away. This was a little bit like an initiation stage-like thing, but it was more like a reading at the same time. So he read my finger, and as a result of that, I was left wondering, and this wondering, this confusion as a result of that, came with a whole new thought process. It was very interesting as an experience. Then the next stage, initiation stage, is called a ritual stage. And I have several people asking me about ritual frequently, because I very often call Tai Chi Chuan a ritual. That is because the different moves in the Tai Chi Chuan, they have meaning, and they are a story in themselves, and you perform the ritual of that story. And there's some very famous rituals in Taoism, like the Steps of Yu, but there's also the state rituals from the Confucian government, and there's the rituals that we have, like daily toothbrushing, daily exercise, and so on and so forth. These are all rituals that you perform because of frequently using them and preventing that they become a habit. And if something becomes a habit, you become inattentive. At the moment when you are in a ritual, it becomes super attentive. So as a result of that, ritual usually also comes in stages, which is sometimes a story, sometimes it's just a repetition of particular kind of mantras or mantic sentences or invocations or prayer, greetings, and so on and so forth. Very often a ritual goes together with food also. And maybe some of my viewers remember that I used to give in my old center before I got to move to the Asbest place. I used to every year do a New Year ceremony, Chinese New Year ceremony, and this ritual was an initiation of the New Year to make you aware of the tricks and tips and tricks of the New Year, basically. Then the next initiation stage is where a teacher shares an experience more directly, and he does that basically through sort of meditative state, where you are sharing in that meditative state. So a teacher shows an experience from his own life through, for instance, meditation or practice, and then you see it, and at that moment this shows where you have to go to. And I remember Wang Guangde, when I saw his at the moment when Wang Guangde, for the first time when I see him, he was moving, making a Tai Chi move as a demonstration, and it was like a dead tree walking. And it was very interesting to see how a piece of wood actually walks. He was filling with his move the whole room, and it was amazing. And I was really looking with big eyes, like, wow, I never seen anything like that. Later on, I found that's an essential part of the Chen Wu myth. So in that sense, as a religious person, he accomplished a lot within the religious movement of Chen Wu worship. And that gave me a clear picture of where I have to go to with my Tai Chi Chuan. And I can see from teachers, that's not it, that's not it, that's not it. So since that time, I have a clear goal. This is where I have to go to. And all the other lines, they are actually not right, because they are not in accord with the Chen Wu myth. That's part of being a Taoist, the Wudang Taoist, of course. I can see my teacher, Yao Xuan De, Sifu Yao Xuan De, he's also wrestling with how to achieve that. And every time when you wrestle with the experience of the direct experience of things, then you go in one direction, you find it's wrong, and then you have to find your way back, and then you have to undo what you have experienced before, and then you have to go to another part. So it's also an experimental path where the end goal is ready. It is a little bit like karma. Karma is caused either by the past or is caused by the future. And in this case, the karma is caused by both the past and the future. And the future is where you want to be, where you need to be, and the past is where you come from. and what has been shown to you at that moment. Then the last stage, that's actually the 5th stage, and that is the melting of selves. That is when a teacher shares his inner experiences with a disciple or with a partner. And it happens in all kinds of stages of life. And this is where I also get it from, that a lot of stages in life, they are already forms of, that rituals are usually referred to stages of life. This was part one from the video about panic and initiation. If you want to see more, then also go look at the second part, which will come out as soon as possible, probably already next week. When you are really interested in these kind of topics, then just sign up for the whole channel. That would of course be the best, because then you won't have to miss anything. You automatically get an announcement at home when the video is ready.